Every morning on my way to work, I used to watch the passing show from a safe distance. It made me ponder the paradox of India's thought. The world is fundamentally unreal. Truth is at the back of things. But it is one thing to be an armchair philosopher and quite another to experience these truths for yourself. Now that I have some time at my disposal, I am going on a quest for that experience.
For 35 years, E.R. Sethuram has worked as a journalist and newspaper editor in Bangalore, South India. He's recently retired, but he often returns to the Deccan Herald as a consultant and to visit old friends.
All my life, I suppose, I've been a seeker for some kind of objective truth. But if there is one thing I have learned from 35 years of journalism, it's that no two men will report a single event in the same way. All truth of this world is only relatively real. But now at 64, I feel the need to seek for a different kind of truth, which is more abiding, more real.
For Sethuram, the problem of retirement isn't keeping busy. It's a time for the most difficult decision of his life.
How are you? I didn't see you for a long time.
What is old age really for? I mean, is it a time just to ruminate on the past? Or can it be something more challenging? The start of something.
So, say goodbye to you for a moment.
Oh, where exactly are you going?
I mean, some places, pilgrimage.
Yeah. Are you going to Sringeri?
Oh, Sringeri, sure.
Perhaps you in the West look at it differently. You see old age as an ending. But traditionally in India, the last stage of life is seen as a new beginning. A time to renounce the world you have known with all its values and attachments and seek for something different.
Indian society traditionally recognizes four stages of life. An orthodox Hindu man passes through the stages of youth, householder, and then a time of seclusion in preparation for the fourth stage, becoming a sannyasin. Sannyasa means to abandon. The sannyasin leaves behind all wealth, personal comforts, and above all his family. His only possessions are his robes, staff, water pot, and begging bowl. The purpose of begging is to humble one's pride. The logic is that if you're nobody, you're closer to God. People humble themselves before a sannyasin because they feel it brings them closer to God themselves. In the past, it was common practice for a man to take sannyas. Today, only a minority even consider taking it. The aim of sannyas is to free the individual from duties so that he can devote all his time to the preparation for mystical experience.
I don't know whether I will eventually have the conviction to become a sannyasin. It seems very remote, but I feel I must discover more about it to see whether it's right for me. But of course, there is a conflict between my own spiritual needs and the needs of my family. It probably seems to you the whole idea is very selfish and irresponsible to abandon one's family. We have always been very close to each other. Now that I'm about to set off, it's not surprising they are very anxious and very hostile.
అందుకోసం అది చెప్దాము అనుకుంటున్నాను. It's not that I'm becoming jumping into Ganges or the Himalayas immediately. This thought is in our tradition.
I know
you can talk very well, you can convince anybody.
But not you, I suppose. Okay?
Not the question of convincing me, but
what
you're doing is just not all right. That's what I feel.
That's very good. If I find out that it's not all right, I will search. No votes here. I know.
We are all against your idea.
I knew that even discussing the idea of sannyas would lead to many emotional problems. Apart from that, there are legal implications too. Legally, what would happen to my family and all my possessions? My relative, S.L. Simha, is an eminent lawyer. I have arranged to meet him at the Bangalore Club, one of the most powerful reminders of the British Raj.
Recently, a retired deputy secretary, after having taken sannyas, he tried to lay a claim to his property. There was a dispute, and the High Court of Andhra Pradesh, finding that all the ceremonies necessary had been performed, held that he was a sannyas and that he had lost all his right, and the property had descended on his sons, and the sons were allowed to take the property.
It can't be revoked.
It can't be. It's in an irreversible process. The consequences of death all ensue. Property passes on to your heirs, and you lose all right to inherit from your former family. And any property that you might acquire subsequent to taking sannyas passes on not to your heirs and the former family, but to your brother sannyas, if there are any. Otherwise, it goes to the state by escheat. So it's a virtual cutting away from your former family and starting a new life. It's as if you are reborn.
I said goodbye to my family. Not such a traumatic parting, because we knew we could see each other again. Even if I did decide to take sannyas, I would have to return home to make arrangements for them. Nothing would be done in a hurry.
Sitaram was born into an orthodox Brahmin family. Sanskrit learning and Hindu rituals shaped him as a child. But later, as he went through college, Western ideas became increasingly influential. For a time, he was a Marxist and then a freedom fighter in the struggle against the British. This is a journey back into his own traditions, to reassess them and to see if they can provide the meaning he is now looking for in this last part of his life. The first stage of the journey takes him to Sringeri, one of the major monasteries believed to have been established by the 8th century philosopher saint Shankara. Sitaram's family has had a long relationship with this monastery, and his grandfather was a sannyasin here. The 8th century philosopher Shankara was the major force behind one of the most important Hindu philosophical traditions, called Advaita, which means unity. It's said that Shankara established the monastery in this spot because he saw here an auspicious sight, a frog resting in the shade of a hooded cobra, its natural enemy. In the Indian tradition, crossing a river has always been a powerful symbol of crossing from this world to the next. The role of the Shankaracharya, or pontiff, is handed down from generation to generation. The present Shankaracharya was initiated as a young boy, and already his successor has been chosen. His disciples fall at his feet out of respect for his proximity to God.
When we come in the presence of a great teacher like the Shankaracharya, the custom is to prostrate. You know, it's not a kind of idol worship. We don't think he's God or anything like that. It's a form of respect towards someone we feel is charged with spiritual power.
Hinduism believes that while man's body is perishable, his inner spirit is immortal and is reborn again and again. It's as if man is condemned to a never-ending succession of labors to perform. The ultimate goal is moksha, or liberation from this endless cycle. The Advaita tradition holds that this is achieved by man taking it upon himself to understand the true nature of reality. Man must actively pursue this knowledge. He must understand, not just believe or guess. Understanding is gained through meditation. The sannyasin develops an attitude towards physical sensations, viewing them as passing experiences, nothing more, nothing less. He then slows down the fluctuations of the mind by concentrating on an image or concept. The goal is to experience the permanent awareness behind the waking and dreaming states, called Atman, or pure consciousness. Once we see our true nature as spirit rather than just as body, we discover that the basic stuff of the world is also spirit and not matter. We also realize that the true identity of ourselves and the world is one. On becoming a sannyasin, a man gives up his caste and lives outside the mainstream of Hindu society. Some of the laity see sannyasins as parasites. A sannyasin has to learn to pocket insults quietly.
ब्रह्म के सिवा उसका अस्तित्व नहीं जैसे घड़े का अस्तित्व मिट्टी के सिवा नहीं, वैसे ही ब्रह्म के सिवा इसका अस्तित्व नहीं। आखिर में तो घड़ा भी तो मिट्टी ही बन जाता है, वैसे ही एक न एक दिन यह जीव जो है ब्रह्म बन ही जाता है। अंधकार में रहते वक्त हमने बहुत कुछ देखा, बोध रूपी सूर्य के उदय होने के बाद कुछ भी देखते ही नहीं है, ये क्या विचित्र की बात है। माने बोध रूपी सूर्य के उदय होने के बाद अपना स्वरूप का ज्ञान हो गया, सारे संसार को भी तो अपने से अतिरिक्त देखता ही नहीं। वासुदेव सर्वमिति।
Sannyasins try to be in the world, but not of it. But the Sringeri pontiffs can't just cut themselves off. As representatives of a thousand-year-old tradition, they fill a ceremonial role for the Hindu laity. For the majority, the experience of their religion is not one of ascetic practice, but often of rich ceremonies. Setaram's stay at Sringeri coincides with the year's most important festival, Navaratri. Presiding over the ceremonies is the Shankaracharya's chosen successor. He follows the ceremonial image of the deity which is carried around the temple. They walk backwards so as not to show disrespect to the deity. The younger Shankaracharya leads a reenactment of an imperial court, giving prizes for Vedic recitation and music. This symbolizes the time when the 14th century Shankaracharya was offered but declined temporal power. The morning after the ceremony, Setaram goes to the younger Shankaracharya to ask for further advice.
పూర్తిగా నివారణ అయింది. ఇంకా లోకంలో ఏమన్నా చూడవలా చేయవలా అని ఉందా లేదా?
అదంతా లేదు అని అనుకుని సన్యాసం తీసుకోవాలా?
అంటే భార్య బిడ్డలు వాళ్ళ మీద ఇంకా వ్యామోహం ఉందా లేదా?
వ్యామోహం సన్యాసం అంటే విడువల.
విడువల సరే, మీ ఇష్టం వాళ్ళకి ఉందా లేదా అని నేను అడిగేది.
లేదు
లేదు అని ఖండితంగా మీ మనసుకు తోస్తే మీకు ప్రపంచంలో ఇంకేవది నాకు చేయవలసి లేదు, నేను సుఖంగా ఆత్మరాముడుగా ఉండేదానికి నాకు అవకాశం ఉంది అని మీకు తోస్తే మీరు తీసుకుండేదానికి లాయక్కు. దానికి మీ మనస్సుకు పరిపాకం వచ్చిందా లేదా అనేది మీరే చూసుకోవాలి.
కాశీకి పోలా, అక్కడంతా చూసి చేయాలా అని ఆలోచన చేస్తూ ఉంటాను. అందుకు కాశీకి పోయితే అనుకూలమవుతుంది అని అంటారా?
అయితే కాశీ అంటే విశ్వేశ్వరుని సాన్నిధ్యం, గంగా తీరం, మరి అన్నపూర్ణ సాన్నిధ్యం, అదంతా ఉంది. ఆ ప్రదేశం నిండా విశిష్టమైన ప్రదేశం.
ద హోల్ ప్లేస్ ఇస్ ఫుల్ ఆఫ్ పీస్ అండ్ ట్రాంక్విలిటీ. ఐ గెట్ సమ్ పీస్ ఆఫ్ మైండ్ త్రూ, బట్ దేర్ ఇస్ అ లిటిల్ డౌట్ పర్సిస్టింగ్. ఆఫ్టర్ ఆల్ the ego cannot be erased by just feeling peace temporarily. The ultimate is jnana, wisdom. Whether we could erase the ego and get eternal peace in sannyas. Anyway, the doubt has arisen in my mind. I will do as Shankaracharya says, go to the holy city and seek some more clarification. I didn't want to travel from place to place endlessly in pursuit of an elusive truth. There are many parables which tell of the man who so relentlessly travels that he fails to see that the object of his search was to be found in the very place he started.
But there's an important reason for going to Benares. Benares represents the world's oldest continuous culture. It has always been a major religious center. Benares is the most sacred place for Hindus. It's built on the banks of the holy river, the Ganges. The popular belief is that whoever dies there attains instant moksha, liberation from the endless cycle of rebirth.
Spiritual seekers have always been drawn to Benares. The atmosphere is extraordinarily vivid and colorful, a great melting pot of questing humanity. If you want to know what Canterbury must have been like in Chaucer's time, you should see the medieval fair, which is Benares. It's strange to think that such a noisy, bustling place is a spot people choose for tranquility and enlightenment.
The place where Setharam stays is called Mumukshu Pawan, which means literally the residence for those who desire liberation. One of the sannyasins living here is known as Judge Swami because he was a high court judge in Delhi before leaving his family to take sannyas.
But you see, my family and a few friends of mine tell me that it's a very selfish purpose. I'm thinking of these things.
Family says so, but this family cannot prevent your death. When God's hands comes, you part with company. And if you part company, then that is dismissal from service. It is compulsion. Nobody can help it. Yes, compulsion. Now, sometime the family may not like you to be there. That I'll call removal from service. Removal from service.
Suspension.
The family doesn't say, no, removal from service. The wife wants to divorce you. The children wants that you get away now, or give us charge of the whole family. That is removal. So why go in for that? Why not voluntarily resign with good grace?
Good grace.
And say, bid them goodbye in good humor, make all provisions for them. You say, I am leaving all the property to you.
How did you feel, Swamiji, when you renounced the ordinary life?
I felt I have completed all my obligation in the world. Now I can rise, fly Godwards completely.
Oh.
Yes.
You felt a glorious feeling came to you.
Glorious feeling. Glorious.
From hundreds of miles around, the dead are brought to be burnt in Benares because of its holy powers. In Benares, death is looked straight in the eye.
It is not fashionable for the householders to talk about death and religion or God ordinarily. But when you have become a sannyasi, then it is the subject to talk about. And the feeling of death is, I am going to my maker. I am going back to my maker where I come from. You talk of religion, that is the boat that will take me there. According to Hindu philosophy, it is just changing of the clothes.
Right.
It is the transmigration of soul, changing of the clothes. From one sort of clothes, you change to another. Otherwise, for the spirit, there is no death, absolutely. Spirit is everlasting. It never dies. Major goal of taking sannyas is to remove fear of death.
Bodies are burnt by the families on the river's bank.
Benares is a place where death is very much on your mind. warnings of the impermanence of worldly things echo throughout Benares. The ancient riverfront is built on the ruins of still older, even greater temples. I think that the fear of death is a starting point of all religious instincts.
In Advaita philosophy, the world is an illusion in the sense that it is not ultimately real. Behind the physical backdrop of the world you travel past lies a deeper spiritual reality. Mystics have described the experience of that reality as pure consciousness, a state where there's no distinction between the inner self and pure being. In moments of calm, you may have a glimpse of that experience, an intuition which may be enough to carry you on. But not all sannyasins rigorously pursue this spiritual knowledge, and not all the rules are obeyed to the letter. In practice nowadays, only a minority go out begging for their food. The majority are fed in their communities.
I suppose, like many Westerners, I had been somewhat naive about the holy men of India. Of course, I knew that not every chap with a long white beard sitting by the Ganges was an enlightened soul. But I had been inclined to give them the benefit of the doubt. After this journey, I think I'm more skeptical. Clearly, there is a danger that the more you go into the self, instead of transcending the self, you can end up with a king-size ego. About one thing, I was totally clear. I would not become a sannyasin merely out of duty as a Brahmin. If I were to do it, it would have to be for the right reasons.
A man becomes a sannyasin by an initiation which includes the ritual performance of his own death ceremony. The initiate first symbolically burns himself on his funeral pyre using an effigy made of wheat, while the priest recites the ritual prayers. Then he performs the death rites. According to Hindu tradition, a transmigrating spirit travels to 16 different worlds and is provided with food for its various stops. The proper ceremonies are performed for guiding the spirit through the realm of ghosts to the heaven of the ancestors.
पश्चिमे भागे नर्मदायाः उत्तरे भागे रेवायाः पूर्वे भागे विक्रमशके बौद्ध.
The initiate performs an atonement for all of his past misdeeds and for those of his ancestors.
विष्णवे नमः विष्णवे नमः
विष्णवे नमो नमः
विष्णवे नमो नमः.
As I watch this death ceremony and imagined what it would be like if I myself was taking part, it hit home exactly how serious and final it would be. Could I really see myself in the place of that man? Would I have the conviction to go through with it?
The sannyasin is shaved, ritually bathed, and given orange robes. He will be regarded as Swarupa Narayana, the living presence of God. At the end of the ceremony, the guru whispers to him a mantra, secret words to meditate upon. Now he is a sannyasin. The man he was several hours before no longer exists.
It was becoming clear to me that the missing link was the right guru. I had yet to find someone who could make the impossible seem possible. But how can you tell the difference between a real and a false guru?
The first important thing is that we have to depend not on any individual, but on our own intellectual certitude. There is a Upanishadic passage which says to the disciple that tvam tatosi guror guruhu guror yogyatva vigyata, because you have to find out who is your guru. Therefore, you who determine the guru-ness of the guru is really the guru of the guru.
Swami Maheshananda is head of the Dakshinamurti monastery. He studied philosophy and science in the United States. He became a sannyasin at the age of 33.
You must not pay too much attention to the personality of the guru, but the message that he is giving. If you are convinced of that message, then that is no more message of the guru, but it is your own message. So, after you have become doubtless, moving to different gurus, having not faith in their personality, but in their message, then you dive deep into this meditation, and as you go deeper and deeper, your knowledge becomes more and more unified, and there is an integrity between what you know, what you feel, and how you act. Once that has been attained, then you will be absolutely harmonious within yourself. And as Gaudapada says, samapraptam na chalayet. Once you have attained to that state of absolute harmony within yourself, you need not worry. Nothing will be able to move you from that position. Now that is what Acharya Shankara says, that unless the disciple can roar like a lion against what the guru is saying, his experience is not complete. So I think your journey will end not by going to a particular individual, but just as a honey bee collects honey from many sources, but makes it into its own. Similarly, the knowledge will be your own. It is never wrong to be late, but it is always wrong to be early in taking sannyasa.
Better to be late than too early. I know it's too early for me. To say goodbye to the world, renouncing everything, demands a great leap from the known into the unknown. If you leap before you are prepared, you will certainly fall into a chasm. I know I am not yet prepared. The sannyasins I talked to made it all sound so easy, but as yet, I don't feel I could really renounce my family. My life is so bound up with theirs, I know that to leave them would cause unhappiness for us all. So how do we weigh up our own spiritual fulfillment against the happiness of the family we love? Maybe one day, I'll find a resolution and will be ready for the leap.
In the West, astrology as a major influence is dead. But in India, almost everybody still consults an astrologer before taking important decisions. The city of Benares is the current center of Indian astrology. By looking at the part astrology plays in India today, we catch a glimpse of the central role it played in civilizations, including our own, throughout the world for thousands of years. Nowadays, most of us look to our stars as a form of entertainment. But for 5,000 years, most people took astrology very seriously, including the greatest and most respected minds. Pythagoras, Thomas Aquinas, and Isaac Newton all used astrology. It seemed undeniable that the movement of the heavenly bodies had a direct effect on man below on Earth. The first known prediction from the stars is found in Babylonian tablets of the 7th century BC. For the pharaohs of Egypt, secret knowledge of the zodiac was at the heart of their power. Ptolemy's Tetrabiblos codified astrology for Western man. Above the earth, the heavenly bodies moved in perfect harmony, creating the music of the spheres and shaping man's life below. By the 16th century, every court in Europe had an astrologer. Elizabeth I consulted hers before fixing her coronation date. After the discovery that the sun, and not the earth, was at the center of the solar system, astrology began to lose its influence. The mechanical view of the universe prevailed. But in India, astrology has remained a powerful influence. The professor of astrology at the Sanskrit University of Benares. Precise and complex calculations are involved, and some of his pupils study for up to 8 years for their degrees. This film does not attempt to assess the validity of astrology, but to show the way it touches and directs people's lives in India today.
In India, it's really difficult for a single woman to live alone with the child. It is difficult because generally a single woman living alone is looked down upon. In India, a woman's place is at home. She is not supposed to work. She is not supposed to have a career.
Benares five-star tourist hotel.
Can I check your room, please?
Jyoti Sengupta works there as a domestic supervisor. Her husband left her with their son more than a year ago, and she doesn't know where he is.
The astrologer, he's more or less like a family doctor to us, you know? Like, when we go to an astrologer, we pour our problems out. So we feel lighter, we feel better. At least there's somebody to listen to me. He has the time to listen to my problems and at least suggest certain things. The astrologer acts as a kind of shock absorber.
The Sanskrit word for astrologer literally means one who knows fate. Jyoti's astrologer, Shambhunath Sharma, has clients who come from all over India and from all walks of life. They include past presidents of India. Sharma claims to be able to see the future because God has given him a glimpse into the divine plan.
What is blotted cannot be blotted. You are being goaded by somebody. You are like a puppet in the hands of the Almighty. What's your present question?
I want to know where my husband is.
I have to tell you one thing very, very important about your husband. He is quite away and far from you. And you may even think of him going to some foreign countries. Mm-hmm. This is the condition. I am telling you the most crucial year of your life is 31st. If you cross through the 31st year till May 1984, a comparative solace will come.
28th of February is my marriage anniversary. So yes. Shall I meet my husband that day?
You should hope it that he should confide you a letter. He may send you or may come himself to see you.
So there is a chance of meeting him?
Yes, that is. When he is coming, yes, you should hope.
Astrologers' replies are often deliberately ambiguous.
Only to give her encouragement and not to lose her heart, I have told that you should hope like that. You should remain hopeful. At times I am talking to a person, but my inner voice tells me, don't confide this thing to him. I don't want to hurt her. Being a human myself, I don't want to dishearten him. This is the theory, and this is human duty towards one human to another.
See, the thing is, I know it may not be a precise prediction, we have that feeling, especially the modern day generation. We feel that way, that maybe the prediction is not absolutely 100% correct. But still, at the same time, when there's somebody to listen to your problems, and give you some sort of advice, I feel lighter and much brave to cope up with the situation to come.
Indudharan Menon took degrees in physics and Western philosophy before going on to study for 4 years with an astrologer.
The role of the astrologer is like a psychiatrist in some sense, you know, equivalent to a Western counselor. There is no confessional or anything in the Hindu system, and the astrologer is definitely somebody a person can rely on in a difficult condition or a difficult situation. A kind of objective view and a guide and advisor. He also performs the role of a priest very often. So he is more like a priest come psychiatrist, counselor, healer also. Sun, Mercury and Rahu, this is the dragon's head, they are in Gemini in the eighth house. This causes the trouble I mentioned earlier, the bronchial trouble. But the planet Jupiter is connected with money.
A chart is drawn up, on the same principle used in the West, by calculating the exact position of the planets at the time of birth. But for a Hindu, there is more than one lifetime to be taken into account.
Jupiter is in the 12th house, which is related with expenditures. Reincarnation is a very important part of this belief in astrology, because what you have done in the past is what you're going to reap. And the astrologer guides a person through these difficult times because he doesn't know what he has done in the past, and he's experiencing it without any understanding in the present life. In Indian society, the belief is that a person is born according to the actions of his past life, and the family and the kind of profession he does, all these are determined by the past life. So there is this strong belief that there is fate, and you're fated to be born in a particular kind of social situation. You're fated to marry a particular person. And so this strong fatalism is one of the main reasons, I think, also why astrology has a strong hold on the Indian mind. The traditional view that man and the universe have a kind of parallelism, they have a resonance in some sense, continues to be believed in India, whereas in the West, the individual is no longer seen as a part of nature, but as somebody who is different from nature, who's trying to fight with nature. Here, the kind of natural events and natural cycles are followed more regularly.
By far the most frequent use of astrology is in the arranging of marriages. Charts are exchanged to determine compatibility.
कभी-कभी ऐसा दो-तीन जगह तो ऐसा हुआ कि मेरे एकदम शादी फिक्स हो गई लेकिन ग्रह के मामले में आके मतलब खत्म हो गई इसलिए कि लोग कहते हैं कि तुम्हारा ग्रह बहुत ज्यादा वो है जो लड़के के ग्रह के साथ नहीं मिल रहा है तो उन लोग लड़के वालों ने हमारा मतलब ग्रह देख के उन्होंने बात को खत्म कर दी
कि इसमें विलंब क्यों हो रहा तो शनिचर केतु का 12वें स्थान बैठना नीच राशि का सूर्य लग्न में बैठना शुक्र के साथ और सप्तम भाव का मालिक मंगल चंद्रमा के साथ बैठ जाए तो ऐसे लोगों के विवाह में बाधा होती नियम फिर कहा बाधा का भी एक लिमिट होता है वो लिमिट समाप्त हो रहा है 29 दिसंबर सन 83 ईस्वी को लिमिट समाप्त हो गया अब इस कुंडली में विवाह का युग लागू हो गया विवाह जन्म स्थान से पूर्व साइट में बड़े संभ्रांत घराने में होगा अच्छे व्यक्ति से होगा पढ़े लिखे व्यक्ति से होगा यह योग शुरू हो गया थोड़ा सा मानसिक स्थिति पर अपने हमेशा कंट्रोल रखा करिए कि मन स्थिति आपकी हमेशा जीवन पर्यंत कुछ न कुछ गड़बड़ाती रहेगी एक साथ कई कई बातें सोचती रहोगी अपने आप घुटती रहोगी और कोई डिसीजन नहीं निकाल सकेंगी जब तक आप कर्म क्षेत्र में बिजी रहिएगा तब तक तो सब सही विवाह के पश्चात एडजस्टमेंट आपका ठीक नहीं रहेगा आप अपने हमेशा अपने पति को क्रिटिसाइज करेंगी समझे ना
In matters of crucial importance, it's quite usual to seek a second opinion. It will cost her 30 rupees, about 2 days' wages.
हाँ गुरुजी, when I get my marriage?
As regards when I looked into your birth chart, there was so many difficulties related to marriage affair till that your age 33rd. You are today running your 34th year and from your Janma Rashi Dhanu, Guru has entered in Rashi Dhanu and now it's all hopeful. Your chances are lurking around and the only thing that you need, you must keep on Tuesday fast and put on one pearl in the right hand ring finger and one coral in your neck along with a red thread. That will be so very helpful for your future life. And now I am getting hope day after day that in the nearest future you will be getting your marriage done.
For 200 years, the Maharajas of Benares have lived in this palace.
I think astrology is most important for every Hindu. Not only my life, but every Indian.
astrology is very important from every angle of his life, right from his birth to death. I consult him on a good day for traveling, good day for signing a document, a good day for doing something new. Even when we buy a new car, we consult an astrologer to find out a good day when we could first sit in the car and drive it. So you see, astrology plays the most important part. We can't do without him. And he's more important to us than a doctor.
The Maharaja of Benares, Dr. Vibhuti Narayan Singh, has five astrologers, each specializing in a different problem.
This is a very interesting document. It is a horoscope of my great great grandfather, who was born in 1783. And this document gives whole history, predictions of his life, and it's made according to astrology.
A horoscope is not just a means for predicting events. At a deeper level, it's a way of developing awareness of man's place in the pattern of the universe. So astrology came to have the same goal as mainstream Hindu philosophy, the knowledge of the inner self. But ever since it was first used to determine an auspicious time for ritual sacrifice, it has also had a very pragmatic purpose.
Even today, astrology has not lost its importance. The politicians, they consult them on all the occasions, right from before they put an application for getting nomination, or when they file their, sign their documents, nomination papers, they consult the astrologer, find a good day and good time, so that they can get through the elections easily.
Like many children in Benares, Swapna does not go to school, but works in a factory to support his family.
हम सुबह जब 9 बजे आ रहे हैं ना, तब हम आ रहे हैं तो काम पर से आ रहे हैं तो 10:30 बज गया, इसलिए हम काम पर नहीं जाए, हमको मारेंगे कहाँ कारखाना में, इसलिए हम नहीं जाएंगे, वो हम चला गया काशी जन ब्रिज, उसमें चल गया, उसमें चल गया, फिर आ गया, फिर आकर घर गया तो अंधार हो गया, तो हमारा बाबू कहा तो कहाँ गए तो हम कहती ये कारखाना में गया एकदम से छुट्टी लेकर आ गया तो हमारा बाबू हमारा मामा से पूछा तो ये देखा सपनवा कितना झूठ कहता तो हम पहले बात खाना खा रहे तब हम कहते बाबू देखो हम जब घर कारखाना में आ गया तब ने गया 10:30 बज गया तब हम सही कह दिला तो हमारा बाबू तब बिगड़े लगा तो कहते जे हमारा मामा के कहते जे हम आए और सीमे से तब उसका मारेंगे इस हमको डर लग गया इसलिए मत्ती का तेल पी लिया इसलिए हमको बेहोश हो गया हमको कुछ याद नहीं है बाद में हमको जो बेहोश आ गया हमको हमारा बाबू कहते जे ऐसे ऐसे 70 रुपया का दवाई ले रहा है और बेचू अस्पताल में लंका बेचू अस्पताल में ले गया
To Swapna's father, a rickshaw driver, 70 rupees is 5 days' wages. His family's had a series of tragedies. Their home was destroyed during the Bangladesh War, and they came to India as refugees. The suicide attempt was the culmination of a series of problems with his son. His astrologer, Gopal Bhaduri, is renowned for his powers of prediction, which he claims come from a goddess called Durga.
आप अपने बच्चे से कुछ मतभेद के कारण उसने आत्महत्या की कोशिश किया और भविष्य में इसके बाद क्या परिस्थिति होगा यही पूछना चाह रहे हैं ना हैं हाँ ना जोर से बोलिए देखिए हाथ देखने से पहले ये विचार करना चाहिए कि जो हाथ आप दिखा रहे हैं या दिखाना चाहते हैं वो हाथ दिखाने के बाद जो भी उत्तर आप मुझसे प्राप्त करेंगे वो अच्छा या बुरा दोनों हो सकता है क्या आप स्थिति में हैं कि अच्छा या बुरा दोनों ही उत्तर को आप सुन सकेंगे ये बुध ग्रह के कारण हो रहे हैं तो इसके लिए आप यदि कोई अर्थ व्यय करके ये करने की स्थिति में तो है नहीं ठीक है ना तो आप केवल बुधवार के दिन व्रत रखिए इसी से आपके पुत्र के मनोभाव परिवर्तन हो जाएगा और पुत्र का मनोभाव परिवर्तन होगा साथ ही साथ जो आप दुखी हैं पुत्र के लिए इसके समाप्तिकरण हो जाएगा
Since this film was made, his problems have not been solved.
So astrology is still living. It can never die in India. It is a human nature. And as long as human nature is there, astrology will always be there.